Questions in a few seconds. I'm going to start asking you a question. You told us about what effect would America have on the Middle East. Mm-hmm. I'd like you to comment on what do you think about the steadfastness, the sumud of the people on the ground in there, mm-hmm. and what's the role of the NGOs in there and in here? Do we see any bright light somewhere by the end of that tunnel, or we have no hope?
Well, I think if you just talk about Palestine, the best things that are happening in Palestine are happening because of Palestinian civil society, and not just NGOs, but the people who organize the BDS movement, the people who are engaged in all kinds of civil resistance against the occupation, are not the politicians or the political parties, not Fatah, not Hamas, not the Jabhat al-Shaabi, but rather people, ordinary people. Organized in NGOs, organized in clubs, organized in unions, organized in municipalities. And the same thing is true in Syria. The same thing is true, was true in Lebanon. The same thing is true in all of these countries where you have awful conflict and governments that are, you know, not really worried very much about their own peoples. Where there is a bright light, it's from civil society, I think.
The idea is our action in here to try to have any influence on the American policymakers and lawmakers, do we have any role? Should we do anything in particular?
Well, I mean, you can only push when the conditions are ripe. I've lived in the United States more than half my life. I was born here. I lived in many other countries, but I've lived here more than half my life. And I have to say, on the Palestine issue, I have never seen the situation so positive in terms of public opinion, not at the political level. Our politicians are bought and sold on Palestine. There's just no hope at this stage. And not even in terms of the media, but in terms of young people, in terms of the campuses, in terms of the churches, in terms of the unions, in terms of activism, in terms especially of the Democratic Party, there has been a sea change. I mean, when I was a student in the 60s, you couldn't say the word Palestine on campus. I mean, we got in trouble. We have Students for Justice in Palestine branches in dozens of American universities, and they're able to go toe-to-toe with the most well-funded campaign you can imagine on the other side. They are able to make the case. And sometimes they succeed, sometimes they fail. There's repression and so on and so forth. But the situation is really changing, and there are numbers to prove this in terms of the way in which, especially in the Democratic Party, people think of issues of justice and Palestine and Israel. There has been a significant change among younger people in the Jewish community, among Arab Americans, among Muslim Americans, among ordinary Americans. There has been a significant change. But this is less true as you go up the age pyramid. Older people are much, and American in the United States are much less likely. It's also less true of Republicans. They're much more pro-Israel than Democrats as a general rule. And that's true. I mean, and that means that there is a scope for activism with our politicians, with the media, and so on.
Thank you very much. Anybody with a question? Yes.
Dr. Khalidi, كريم كثير. وانا انبسطت بكلامك.
الله يخليك.
حابب اتعلم منك شيء اذا بقدر بتعلم.
تشرف.
أنا ولدت في بلاد الشمس من 1940 وجيت على أمريكا من 72
تمام
واليوم بحمل جنسيتين يعني أنا شايفني واحد مايك بس أنا اثنين والصراع الصراع هذا بشخص واحد شخصين بشخص واحد بعتقد منه موجود عندي موجود عند كل واحد يمكن أقل شيء عندي أنا لعندي أنا بحكي وصريح غيري بخاف بخون ما بيعرف أيه هو بلده أنا بقدر أعرف إنه أنا وطني سوريا ومسكني أمريكا هالصراع هذا هون كيف بدنا ننهي حتى الإنسان يشعر إنه عايش بنتفة سلام داخلي وحدي أنا عم أطلع عن الموضوع لأنه أنا بحب رفرف مطرح اللي حقي اني رفرف مع ترامب وهيك انا ما بدي رفرف خلي رفرف على ذوق انا ببني على ذوقي وبعدين برفرف على ذوقي انا بيجي بقول له للدكتور خالدي تفضل علي وعلمني معنى الفرديه ماني عم اقدر افهمها كل الناس بيفهموها بس انا ماني على قد بفهم لاني وقت بشوف واحد بيقول لي انا بفهم الفرديه وهو فردي ومريض فيها ومن غمس لروته ما بعرف بفهم بيوقف عقلي معنى الاجتماعيه بدنا نفهم معنى الاجتماعيه نحن بدنا نفهم معنى الوعي بدنا نفهم معنى بدنا نفهم معنى الوعي والادعاء الوعي بنقصد فيه هون المعرفة بدنا نفهم معنى الادعاء وقت اللي بنطلب من هالقاعدة هيدي كلها وأنا ما بدي إياك توضح لي إياها لأنه هي ما بتتوضح هلا بس هالجيل الجديد النشيط هالقد خليه يسعى دكتور جورج يونين دكتور أدمير كورية دكتور بشار الجعفري حضرتك أنا محتار الدكتور بشار الجعفري ليش من وبيننا وهو سمبل يعني هو مثال لقلنا كل يدنا بيفشلنا خلقنا عمليه بقى رجاء إذا ممكن الجيل الجديد مع الدكتور خالد وعونا خلينا نصير بالأول بشر بعدين بنروح بالأمم ونحرمها نحن بالأول البيس ما عنا إيه ما تأخذوني أنا فشيت خلي هلا لأنه أنا ما عندي ظرف كتير إني فش خلي دكتور
Thank you very much Thank you. Please go ahead. Your question. If I can hear you, I might be able to see it on the laptop.
Sir Khalid, أنا من مواليد القدس 1940.
نعم.
أنا هجر من بيتي في القدس الغربية.
تمام.
48.
أي حي؟
بالبقعة الفوق.
تمام.
تعرفها.
سيدي زبطة عرفت
وأنا لما سألت حضرتك إنه دكتور خالدي عرفت إنه من الوقت
تمام
عائلة قريبة
الله يخليك
كل ما تحدثت به هل تعتقد أنه كان حصل لو وافق أمين الحسين على تقسيم 29 نوفمبر 1947 كان كل هذه التراجيدي اللي صارت في الوطن العربي وخسارة تريليونات الدولارات اللي خسرناها في بلادنا كان حصلت هاي لو وقفنا على التقسيم كان حصل لم تحصل
The question was This is a gentleman from Jerusalem. He was born in 1940 in a neighborhood in West Jerusalem called Baqa al-Tahta. And his question is, would the tragedy that followed have taken place had Haj Amin approved of the partition of November 29th, 1947? Hajawab bil-Inglisi, جوابي بالعربي بسيط. جوابي بالعربي بسيط جدا. لا. أنا مش من رأيي إنه لو الحاج أمين والقيادة الفلسطينية وافقت على التقسيم كان الوضع أحسن ما هو بالعكس أنا تقديري إنه اللي صار كان شبه حتمي كانت نتيجة ضعف الفلسطينيين وضعف العرب قوة الحركة الصهيونية وقوة العملاقين اللي هما كانوا وراء الحركة الصهيونية كانت حصلت تقريبا نفس النتيجة ربما بغير أساليب. Let me answer in English very quickly. I do not think that had the Palestinian leadership in 1947 accepted the partition resolution, which would have given most of Palestine to a 30% minority, that we would have had a very different outcome. There might have been a different outcome had the Palestinians behaved differently earlier. أنا كاتب كتاب وبقترحه على سيادتك اللي هو عنوانه بالإنجليزي The Iron Cage. I wrote a book called The Iron Cage in which I talk about the failures of the Palestinian leadership. There were many failures. Failures of Haj Amin, failures of other realms of leadership. I don't think 47 was the biggest failure. There are many other failures.
So I have a question, Doctor. As far as our newer generation, you're an expert here, what do you think we should do as a collective, you know, Syrian descent, basically? What should we do? How should we train them? And how should we channel them, basically, so that we have more impact on government itself, since we just established that regardless of the president's name, figure, or political affiliation, things don't change.
Right.
How are we going to implement this change, basically?
That's a good question.
I think there are two things that people like us of the older generation can do, or me anyway, and those of us who are older. I think we have to get more involved in the country we live in. Earlier someone said, I only live here. If you think you only live here, if your heart and your soul are somewhere else, then you can't do this. And that's fine. But if you think that you don't just live here, but you have rights here and duties here, and you pay taxes that fuel what this country does, which we all do, then it's our responsibility, especially the older people, to try and use that influence within the system. But my advice as far as the younger generation is different. I think we should get out of their way. Because they're going to be smarter than we were in dealing with this country. They feel more at home in this. I've lived half my life in the Arab world. I think of myself as يعني هذا الانفصام اللي تكلمت عنه يعني في منه أنا مواليد نيويورك بحس فيه هذا الانفصام. This generation they don't have that. They don't have that. They have their own identity. And they have no doubts about that, but they understand themselves to be Americans. معليش بس بدي
مش المرضى نحن المرضى
نحن بدنا نتعامل تمام فأنا بقول أنا بقول معك إنه we should get out of their way. أنا افتكرتك مسافر يا أخي أنا تلي إنك مسافر أنت جاي من فلوريدا.
Any more questions, gentlemen?
There wasn't.
You weren't in Florida? Inshallah. Tafadhal.
Yes, we have a question in here. I'm sorry.
Answer this young lady's question.
We have a question in there first. Please go ahead, George.
I have a question concerning the Palestinian question.
Yes.
I'm not a big fan of the two-state solution,
uh-huh.
But it's proved that it's not going to work. It's dead. So, and it doesn't matter. So I'm not talking about how we believe. The way we believe, it's not going to fly in this country. But how do we approach it? How are we going to explain to the American audience that the two-state solution is not a viable solution? And how do we approach it without being labeled as anti-Semitic?
Right. For example, it's a good question.
One of the things that we thought about it is to tell people that if you want peace in that part of the world and in the Near East, let's have states, secular states, and democratic states. So when you talk about secular states, it means you can abolish any sectarian or religious state.
Right.
Is that a good approach? It should be more specific into human rights more than a two-state solution. Mm-hmm. Because maybe if it's one solution with equal rights to Palestine, maybe we have a better chance in the future to claim our land. So this is
the
question.
I agree completely with the premises of your question. I think that the two-state solution
has been destroyed by Israeli behavior over 50 years.
And that whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, it's a dead idea. Now, how do you show that? That's really the heart of your question, without making it appear that you're anti-Semitic or extreme or whatever. I think you talk about, first of all, what Israel has done to make a two-state solution impossible. So you go talk about details, like they control 3/4 of the occupied territories and they've refused to give it up. Or you quote Netanyahu as saying, we want permanent, complete security control. Khalas. There's no state, there's no sovereignty in a situation where Israel has security control. Security control is control. Control is sovereignty. Sovereignty is statehood. No statehood. Intaha. That's the first thing. So you talk about why they have made it impossible. And then you talk about principles, in my view. I think the thing to talk about is justice and equity. Whatever one people is entitled to, whatever one group is entitled to, whatever one individual is entitled to, every other people, every other group, every other individual must be entitled to. There must be equality. I mean, this requires a democratic system. This probably requires a secular system because a sectarian system doesn't allow for those things. But that's the way I would approach it. And that's the way I do approach it. You cannot have a right of a law of return for one group and no right of return for another group. You can't have security demands that we put you in prison and the other group doesn't have security as a result. So the whole system involves injustice, insecurity, inequality, and that is, you can't have a solution on that basis. So that's how I would approach it.
Thank you. There's a lady in here.
Young lady here.
Young lady.
I'm Nicole. I graduated from Mafia College, and I've read many of your books.
Mm-hmm.
My Middle Eastern studies.
Mm-hmm.
And based on the history that we proceed from.
I'll repeat the question. Don't worry.
Do we see a world war coming in my generation? Or in
a
future?
Yeah, I started by saying I don't predict the future. So I can't really answer your question. Do I foresee a world war coming? Yeah, inshallah, man. What can I say? I don't know. I think there's some very dangerous elements in the world today. I think there are some unpredictable elements in the world today. I think that for the most of the powers that have the weapons that are the most fearsome, the nuclear powers, there seems to be a mutual assured deterrence, even between the United States and Russia, between China and Russia, between the United States and China. But you have wild cards. You have North Korea. You have a president in the United States who's a little bit unpredictable. So I hope not. I think that how the United States deals with rising powers in the 21st century. Most of us will be dead in 2050. Young people like you still have maybe 20 more years. In 2050, the world's going to look very different. China and India will be much more important countries than they are today. No matter what happens, they're going to be more important. The United States and the European countries, Russia, will probably be a little less important. How the world comes to terms with those kinds of changes, countries like Brazil, countries like India, I think that'll determine whether we have a stable world or not. World war, yani inshallah, la, ma, ma. Can't answer. Maybe one or two more so that people can
hear. Only one question left, please, because two questions, okay. Because the professor has to eat too, you know. Please go ahead, stand.
So, I have a couple questions.
You're allowed one because.
Stand up so I can hear you.
So,
what's the reason for so many countries involved in the proxy war in Syria? Is it positional? Is it financial? Why are so many countries involved in the proxy war in Syria? What is it, just strategic? Or another question, I was invited as a doctor without borders to go to Syria. Would you go if you were a doctor? Because I don't feel too comfortable about it.
Part two, but I can't answer the second part of your question. Yeah, that's very difficult. I mean, I have to advise my own students for whom I feel responsibility about going to dangerous places, and I'm very hesitant to offer advice. I have students who've gone and worked in Syria, but it's very dangerous. So, I mean, that goes back to you. I have a daughter who's an archaeologist. She's worked in Syria. She's worked in Yemen. She is now in Ethiopia. And she doesn't listen to me. She does whatever she wants. And I wish she wouldn't go to some of the dangerous places. So, you know, I can't answer that. What drives the war in Syria is partly strategic interest, in particular on the part of Russia and Iran. I think for both of these countries, they see the maintenance of the regime in Damascus as in their vital interest. They are deeply committed to this. And one of the things that I find frivolous about the policy of the United States and Saudi Arabia is they never really paid serious attention, and other countries, and Turkey, is they never paid serious attention to this. You know, this has nothing to do with the merits or the virtues or the demerits or the flaws of Russia or of Iran. I'm just saying, in realpolitik terms, Russia is not going to allow a country in which it has been involved since 1955, one of its two first areas of influence outside the communist bloc, to disappear. It just wasn't going to allow that, especially after what happened in Libya. Iran is even more committed than Russia. And that's a fact. Now, you can negotiate with them, or you can try and defeat them, but you have to be more determined than they are. And neither Turkey, nor Israel, nor Saudi Arabia, nor the United States, nor Britain, nor France, nor any of the others, for none of them was this an absolutely vital interest. None of them were willing to put the kind of weight into this conflict that both Russia and Iran have over 4 or 5 years proven that they were willing to put in. So that's those in the case of those two countries, in my view, what's driving them is vital national, what they see as their leadership see as vital national interests. For the others, it's important. For Turkey and Saudi Arabia, it's very important. But I don't think they have the same, there's an American expression, skin in the game, that Russia and Iran have, frankly. And they've proven that by their inconstancy, by their weakness, by their vacillation, by their changing policy.
We're not able to hear you. Thank you. Please, the last question. Speak up. We're still not able to hear.
Yeah. I talked about the hunger strike, yes. Yes.
In regards to him, in recent times he's been saying that he would be a successor to Mahmoud Abbas and the PA. Is that realistic, and what are your views in regards to Marwan Barghouti?
Yeah. The question was about Marwan Barghouti. He said, I made a reference to the fact that he is leading a hunger strike of 1,500 prisoners in Israeli jails. And would he be a worthy successor to Mahmoud Abbas? In my view, yes. I think we should, any of us who wants change in the Palestinian national movement should support Barghouti and the whole generation of younger leaders. I think that the leadership of the whole Palestinian national movement has basically failed. And it's time for another younger generation to step in. And he's shown by his ability to unite people from different factions and by his leadership that he's a much better option. The problem is the Israelis are very unlikely to let him out of jail. So I think launching a campaign to portray this man as the new Nelson Mandela, to pressure them, force them to release him, would be an important step. I would warn you, though, Israel since the 1930s has used assassination as a tool against Palestinian leaders. One of the things we can say with some certainty is that he's unlikely to be killed in an Israeli prison. He might be in some jeopardy if they ever were to release him. Ad-Dinya. Allah khalli.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khalid.